Chapter 18, A UFO in Phoenix. I must confess I never saw the photos, nor did I watch Dan Rather on network TV telling us all about this amazing event. My experience with the 1997 UFO sighting near Phoenix, Arizona, only came secondhand from people living nearby, from others in the area by accident, and from still others around the country who caught the TV coverage. Like most people who are accustomed and concerned with spiritual growth and helping others, in my case, through meditation, teaching, and study, I'm usually not too interested in sensational events. But with this particular UFO sighting, I think it's important to consider some of the implications. First of all, the public response, ranging from indifference to fear to outrage at the cover-up, was not surprising, nor was the official level of non-response. The governor of Arizona even suited up one of his assistants in alien garb to draw laughs at a news conference. The location of the sighting, right in the middle of what I and many UFO researchers consider secret alien base land, was no shock, nor was the fact that it hung around to be seen, apparently, for over an hour. Despite all this, if we analyze the whole event in relation to the long-suspected official alien disclosure plan, this was not an insignificant event. If we're interested in getting a better sense of what's coming down the line in the next 5 years, we can learn a lot from this UFO in Phoenix. Dr. Richard Boylan, a psychologist and UFO researcher, has made many predictions over the years regarding the imminent official disclosure of ET information. Unfortunately, but not surprisingly, few of these have come true. So much for timelines these days. They're nearly always wrong, which is also the case with predictions of Earth changes and UFO mass landings. The vast majority of these claims, sadly, serve only to discredit the claimant. Nevertheless, we do see geological upheaval brewing, and there do continue to be UFO sightings, isolated landings, and direct contacts around the world. The moral to the story here is somewhat subtle. Even a misled messenger may bear some of the truth, and the reality of an overall trend cannot be dismissed by apparent setbacks and mistaken details. Although Dr. Boylan's dates have been wrong, I do think there has been and continues to be a public conditioning program in regard to UFOs and ET life. I agree that some form of disclosure does lie ahead. If we consent with the general theory that a deliberate UFO cover-up from the U.S. government, military, and media sources is going on, we may rightly ask about this Phoenix saucer's nationwide primetime television coverage. Why did it happen at all? The same network of information control that has kept decades of UFO reports from U.S. print and electronic media existed both before and after the Phoenix event. The media forces that blacked out previous sightings could have blacked out this one, but they didn't. Was it simply a case of media overwhelm? Over 10,000 local people were said to have seen the UFO, many of whom took video, or was there some deliberate intention behind the apparent break in media silence? Exactly how did this information find its way onto family TV viewing sets across the nation? Following this same line of reasoning, we need to look at the function of this event in the overall plan and timeline for official UFO disclosure, if we assume that such a secret policy really exists. And from this stone, we jump to the next. Just who was the pilot of this ship? Simply put, either it was made on Earth or it wasn't. Putting aside for the moment those craft that are the result of secret human-based technologies, let's look at the second choice, a genuine alien visitation. In that case, at least according to the metaphysics I trust, we must then consider either a positive or a negatively oriented ET source, either of whom may appear in our skies, yet whose agendas are vastly different. In discussing the benevolent groups, Ra noted that, quote, their purposes are very simple, to allow those of your planet to become aware of infinity, which is often best expressed to the uninformed as the mysterious or the unknown, end quote. You could certainly say the Phoenix UFO was a mysterious unknown that helped some people become aware of infinity. But is that enough to conclude that it came from those ETs here to help humanity? Actually, this is not enough information. To really figure out which group could have been running this particular craft and therefore what role, if any, it played in the ongoing disclosure drama, there are two other points we should consider, both of which come from the raw material. I'm relying on this particular source in our discussion because it supports our discernment, yet it also doesn't shy away from calling a spade a spade. While discussing benevolent ET craft sightings, those that come from what Ra calls the Confederation, see Section 1, Inside the Confederation, Ra indicates that, quote, they appear in thought-form capacity for those who have eyes to see, end quote. Even if the Phoenix ship was a thought-form or holographic image, can we really imagine that all 10,000 people who saw it, quote, had eyes to see, meaning that they had spiritually prepared themselves for such a revelation? I really don't think so. This is the first sign, at least to me, that it was not, quote, the good guys who are hovering over Arizona to wake people up. Secondly, in another volume of their teachings, Ra notes that mass sightings or UFO flaps are all from Orion, which is the main group behind negative ET contact, such as abductions, implants, mutilations, and high-tech weaponry transfers. While we may think that such high-visibility UFO publicity, such as the Hudson Valley, New York flap several years ago, serves to awaken the masses to the reality of UFOs and thus boost our spiritual growth, Ra flatly disagrees. Quote, this assumption is incorrect. The flaps cause many fears among your peoples, many speakings, understandings concerning plots, cover-ups, mutilations, killings, and other negative impressions. Even supposedly positive reports which gain public awareness speak of doom. The audience brought about by Orion-type publicity, meaning UFO flaps, is not seeded by seniority of vibration to a great extent. The other, or non-random audiences receiving, quote, requested teaching without stimulus from publicity will be more oriented towards illumination. I repeat, the other, or non-random audiences receiving requested teaching without stimulus from publicity will be more oriented towards illumination. Point here is that although some people gain inspiration from random UFO mass sightings, most people end up further confused. Furthermore, since the audience getting this kind of negative ET or Orion-based UFO publicity is not comprised of people with active spiritual seeking, few of them can even use these experiences for personal growth. It's like being given an esoteric initiation when you're not particularly interested. The seeds will lie on rocky ground. Bearing all this in mind, especially the randomness of the viewers and their disoriented response, I think it's doubtful this was a positive ET Confederation ship hoping to awaken the local residents of Phoenix. This only leaves two other possibilities, an Orion greeting or a craft made on Earth. If it was the former, an Orion ship doing as it pleased, as I suspect it was, then such a brash display is certainly no cause for celebration. It suggests much greater boldness and a show of undisputed force on their part and almost smacks of taunting our human so-called leadership. If it was, on the other hand, the product of secret human technology, then it certainly fits into the continuing drama of social ET conditioning, preparation for more disinformation to come. In fact, according to Dr. Boylan, quoting Colonel Philip Corso, reported in UFO Focus magazine, page 4 of the winter 1997 issue, the U.S. government does possess, quote, enormous black triangle anti-gravity craft back-engineered from extraterrestrial UFOs, end quote. Of course, this, too, could be a piece of disinformation meant to assure conspiracy followers that such a huge ship is really one of ours. In any case, that local city authorities had to fight state and federal authorities for investigation is irrelevant, since the locals were surely out of the loop, as they are peripheral to the plans of either source, either Orion ET or Black Agency Earth-based groups. Both of these groups are quite adept at cover-up operations, which is the main reason why so many questions remain. Personally, I'm not sure which of these two groups was responsible for the huge craft hovering before a stunned Phoenix audience, but in either case, we're certainly seeing the progression of Earth's end times. This third and final act scene involves the last power bids of both groups, the negative ETs who know, at some level, that Earth's 3D cycle is coming to a close, and with it, their presence here, as well as those power elite human groups who seek world domination and also hear the clock ticking. I cannot say for sure whose craft it was, and like most of us, I can only make an educated guess based on intuition and reason. I am sure, however, that this event was no accident, that it was part of someone's overall plan, and that we have not seen the last of it. So, you may ask, how to proceed in a world gone mad? How to keep balance when everyone around us seems to be drunk while the social fabric is tearing? We have certainly seen other dramas before, such as the Heaven's Gate mistake, the Hale-Bopp implosion, Sheldon Neidl's masked landing blowout, and many UFO disclosure predictions gone flat. As usual, conflict and controversy surrounds the field, and it's quite easy to fall for the fantasy of the hour. Interestingly, while most of us feel called to help out and serve in a world deeply divided, to keep from being overwhelmed by externals, we have to go deep inside. As Earth hurtles towards its own bright destiny, such strange events will continue. Our challenge is to keep clear.